Good morning, everybody. At the outset, I'd like to thank Dr. Arup for giving me this opportunity. In fact, after seeing Dr. Sriganesh's elegant videos, now I don't know whether you people are interested in this particular simple surgery. As Dr. Arup said in the beginning, iris claw lens is one which is becoming more and more popular because it's easier, faster, and learning curve is very less. But we can also suture the eyeball to the iris. I'll just go through the videos. So this is a case where it's a case of pseudo exfoliation where the bag came off and it's FAK without any capsular support. So it had to be, I thought of fixing the eyeball to the iris itself. Not playing. Yeah. So now you see the lens is being implanted. This is a rigid three-piece eyeball being implanted into the eye. The leading haptic goes behind the iris. Now the rest of the trailing haptic is also put in the antechamber. Now using the Microlex's forceps, this haptic also is placed behind the iris, taking care to see that the optic still remains in the antechamber. This is sort of a total optic capture. Now here, as you lift the optic, you can see the iris draping the, iris draping the haptic, and then you can get the mark of the haptic here. You pass the needle through the cornea, through the mid periphery of the iris and posterior to the haptic, and then come out through iris and then the cornea. So the same thing is repeated on the other side also. Now the loose end is, the free end is taken out completely, and then a loop from the other end which is attached to the needle is taken. Now a three clockwise knot is placed. As you pull this suture, the knot slips in. You don't have to take instrument inside. Same thing is repeated. The loop is taken again out and another single knot is placed. So like that, about 3 to 4 times you'll have to do it till you get a firm, secure knot. So how exactly you know that it is tied? You can see a fold on the iris at this place, and the same thing is repeated on the other side. This I'm using 10-0 rolling here. 9-0 would be better, because of more tensile strength, and the longevity is better, and then since it's a thicker material than 10-0, handling becomes a little easier. Once you know that both the sides it is tied properly, then now you can put the optic back behind the iris. And this step is not really required. Sometimes that can cut the suture here, the knot can be open. So this way you can achieve. But though it's an edited video, and it takes time. So this is another case of pseudo exfoliation where there is no capsular bag at all. So this is a different technique of suturing the lens. So now the needle is passed through the mid periphery of the iris, or little closer to the peripheral part of the iris on either side. This is a 10-0 proline again, and using a Sinsky hook, a loop is brought out here. Now, using that girth hitch or claw hitch technique, to get a firm grip on the haptic, so the haptic is secured here on either side, and now the whole thing is placed, and this suture is tied in the same way like I showed in the previous video. So this way you can secure the thing properly to the iris, and since it's a three-piece lens, the angulation is around 10 degrees, so the optic is quite behind. There is no iris chafing or anything. The only problem is, in case if suture undergoes biodegradation or later on, there can be decentration of the eyeball. So now coming to the most popular technique, that is the iris claw lens. I'll just take a few seconds here to explain. So this is the lens here, which is about, this is the lens which has got concave concave surface anteriorly and convex posteriorly. It is vaulting backwards, and then this has got a closed loop haptic which is broken here to give this pincers or claws, and the range is around +3 to +30 diopters. This is made of PMMA, and these are the various lens holding forceps which can be used. Even this is the Kelman IOL holding forceps which we used to do in the beginning of IOL implantation surgery, and this is to enclave the IOL. Here you can use a separate tucker for the iris, or you can use a 26 gauge cannula, or even your Sinsky hook will do the work for you. And this is the concept. Once it is held in by this claw, it will remain fixed like that, and you can see the here the optic, the entire IOL is much posterior to the iris surface, so the iris chafing is not an issue. So the contraindication, since it's an iris based surgery, so any abnormalities of the iris has to be careful. This is exactly how I do. This is the case of a fake again with the cortex here and the vitreous and antechamber. Now these two side ports that you make should be exactly the place where you are going to tuck the iris. So after antivitrectomy, under viscoelastic, and we can, if the pupil is dilated like this, then it may pose some problems. So I prefer to constrict the pupil using a pilocarpine intracameral. And this is the lens. Before implanting the lens, one has to check whether the claw is open or not, whether that end is broken or not. After that, place the lens in the antechamber and let the optic cover the pupillary area, pupil exactly, and then mark the place. Look for the landmarks where you are going to do the tucking. Under viscoelastic, using a lens holding forceps, which is available with every Indian instrument maker, then push one haptic first with the other haptic over the iris, and then lift the iris. You get the mark where exactly the claw is, and then tuck the iris. Same thing is repeated under viscoelastic on the other side. So the end point here is look for the cleft, that fold on the iris. Only then you can go ahead with the tucking of the second haptic. So once it is done, now push the optic behind, and it's advisable to do a peripheral iridectomy. With the vitrector itself can be done. So pupil can dilate up to 8 millimeters almost, so posterior segment examination and the management of the posterior segment problems is not a problem at all. This is another case where there was an iris defect, as you see here, following the first initial surgery. So you can't, even after putting pilocarpine, still there's a defect that we can see. So I'm suturing the iris here using the same 10-0 proline. Like what he showed, that SFT type of suturing. Here, again, just pull out the free end and make a loop of this, and then three throws clockwise, and then pass the knot inside. So even this also I could have sutured. Now you have got a nice round pupil. So the orientation is going to be in this direction. So that means you have to make side ports exactly the place where you are going to tuck the iris. So this way it can be done in any direction. It is not without any complications. There are certain complications associated with that. One is the pupil ovalization. This is mainly because the tucking is closer to the pupillary margin. Second thing is pigment dispersion that we were discussing. So that is another problem that may predispose the eye to develop glaucoma. And then there can be disenclavation, and then there can be decentration or even dislocation of the eyeballs also, and there can be tilting of the eyeball because it's a two-point fixation. The iris can undergo atrophy at the place where you have tucked the thing, and then that may result in disenclavation. And in case if the peripheral iridectomy is not done, which the company doesn't recommend that you should do peripheral iridectomy in every case because of the vault and other things, still, this is without peripheral iridectomy, and after YAG iridotomy, this is exactly how the antechamber looks. So it is always better to do either prior to surgery or on the table with the vitrector itself. So in case if enclavation is not proper, then the lens can get decentered a little bit. the lens can tilt because it is, as I told you, it's a two-point fixation. So you can still re-enclave the disenclavated diver. That means even if it is decentered, it's held at only one point, you can bring it out. And then in case if the iris is atrophic in that area, maybe you can change the orientation and then enclave the diver. There are a lot of studies to show that it is good in children also. In fact, many people who are doing iris steel fixated eyeballs in children, they have shifted to the iris claw eyeball. And there are studies to show that this is a better technique as compared to the transcleral suture fixation in those cases without capsular support. So advantages of the technique are that it has got a very short learning curve and it is very fast. And patient's early visual recovery is possible in this. Thank you very much for your patient listening.